First of all, we have this so-called processor memory gap. So horizontal axis is time, so it's years, right? So unfortunately, this is very old. The vertical is the performance. It's also log scale. You have to be careful, right? 1, 10, 100, 1,000, right? So everything straight line here is mean exponential, okay? The red line is CPU speed. So CPU improve, we know that, right? We did a bit of calculation in the beginning of the class. And the green line is the speed of memory. You may ask why the memory is so slow, because it's nothing we can improve, right? We have done the best. If we say, oh, that's too bad. Not too bad. That's very good, okay? Because it's very difficult to improve memory because there's nothing to improve. It's just simple flip-flop. Okay, you try to squeeze them, you try to make it as small, but there's nothing else more you can do. So it become like this. The time goes by, the speed of CPU and we have to say it's a dynamic RAM, the one that you can buy and put in to increase the amount of RAM in your machine. Okay, that kind. There's many kind. So the gap, we can say, quite a lot. Okay, now the gap, let's say DRAM here, maybe let's say it's 10 and CPU here is 1,000. So it's 100 times the speed different. Okay, right? So that is the first reason. So what we do to make the processor, when you read from the memory, the first thing you read is the instruction. So we have the instruction memory, right, and fetch the instruction from the instruction memory. You can say, okay, let's separate that and to be a separate memory. It's okay, we can make that one fast memory. Okay, that's not too bad. How about your data? The data is properly in the RAM. Okay, so you have no way to avoid it. And if you remember our CPU control, stage 4 is read and write memory, right? And stage 5 is write back. So stage 4, you have to read or write the main memory. And if there are 100 times slower than your processor, then your processor have to stop and wait for, or your pipeline will be so big, right? So it's impossible to do the pipeline. So what we assume using this pipeline is the speed of the reading the memory is quite fast, maybe 2 times slower is okay. 10 times, 100 times is unacceptable. So maybe 2 times slower. So how to do that? We have to have a especially fast memory, right? But hey, if it become a special kind of memory, it become possible, I mean economically possible. The way to make the data access to the main memory faster is to build a small amount of memory that is very fast. But that is not the RAM. So we have to copy the part of the RAM into this fast memory. We call it cache memory. Okay. So every time we want to access, we can access this memory. Let's say this memory is ideal, as fast as processor. Usually the fast memory that is nearest to the processor, okay. Right? We call first level cache. Okay. First, because it's first class, it's nearer to the processor. We can have a second level, third level. Usually now we have 3 level for the server for the CPU in the server. To the data warehouse, the higher class is a bit slower, but it's larger and larger. Yeah. So let's forget about many levels. Let's just say cache, the first level cache, so to speak, will be try to be as fast as processor. Mm-hmm. And maybe different, maybe just 2, 1 time slower than processor, but that go into that detail. So we have very small fast memory, and we copy some part of the memory to this small fast memory. Automatically in hardware, there's no programming involved. For us, writing the assembly language program and executing it, we don't know about this kind of thing at all. It happened by magic inside the CPU. Okay. So why that work? Because you cannot copy all the RAM. You can copy only some part of it. Okay, that is possible because of these two properties. Okay. We have temporal locality. That means the trick of using this fast memory to be effective is that whenever you want a piece of data, it's already there in the fast memory. But how can it be possible? Okay, the first property is that whatever we access, just last time, okay, maybe just a second ago, is more likely to be accessed again now. Or whatever we access now is more likely to be accessed again in the near future. Okay, we call that temporal. And that means we sort of have some habit. If we access some data, it's more likely that we will access data again soon. Okay, that is the characteristic. How we know? We just check. We run a lot of program and we check and we say, this occurs most of the time. Very easy. If rather than thinking in terms of data, you think in terms of program, because the matching code is also a kind of data reside in the same RAM. Let's say that the instruction, if you're instructed within the loop, it's likely that you go back to the same instruction, right? Secondly, is space or spatial locality. Okay, this is applied more to the data. If you access one location, your neighborhood is most likely to be accessed next. Very, very easy, right? That means two locations which is close together is more likely to get access. It's not random. Right? If you say, I just access location 110, it's more likely to access 111 more than other place. We observe this from execute the real program. The reason very easy, most of our data come into in a kind of block or array. An array we usually sequentially access. We have some difficulty if it become data structure like a tree and other thing, right? But most of the time, this property is true. Therefore, if we expect this kind of two property, that's the only two property, right? Then we can say, if we access to one thing here, we keep it there because maybe the next very short time, we will access again. If we access this location, it's very, very possible that nearby location will be accessed again. So when we read from the memory to copy into this fast memory, we copy as a block rather than copy just one, we copy a few, and by hoping that if I copy 110, 111, if I access 110, I also copy 111, expecting that 111 will be accessed soon. Okay. Now, if everything going as planned, then we call the cache is hit. We found what we want in the fast memory, so processor go full speed. What happened is it missed. The special circuit has to say, okay, let's wait, and I read from the main memory into the fast memory, and then send information to the processor. Okay. The processor has to wait. We call that miss. The whole idea of designing this memory is, what is the size of the cache that can give us the good performance? Of course, we want to make it as big as possible, but that's expensive. Actually, when we design, we want it to get it to as small as possible within the performance goal. If we want to hit 90%, right? We want to make sure that it has certain size that can hit 90%. Okay. What kind of trick we use to choose, right? What to copy and when we want to copy and where we are going to copy. Okay, what, when, I think what is it? It's moot. We have to copy what the professor wants, okay? Right, so it's more like a where and when, okay? Because it is small, fast memory, right? You have many locations that you can copy to, right? You can copy sequentially, you can copy randomly, you can copy as a block, you can copy as an individual. There's so many ways you can arrange it, okay? And when is mean, once I want to copy the new one, if every slot in my fast memory already used, which old one I must retire, yeah? You have to replace, you cannot copy everything. So you have to decide which the older guy I want to kick off of from my fast memory and replace by my new one. All right, and we see the hierarchy. Using this kind of trick, we have the processor, which is highest speed, right? And we have the small memory, which is called the first level cache, right? And then the main memory, no? The, maybe this is the second level cache, and this is your RAM, which is you can buy and slot into your notebook, okay? So it's the size getting bigger and speed getting slower. This is because the trade-off between size and speed to keep the cost constant. So this show you the kind of spatial representation. If this is a big RAM, and you can copy only a part of it into your smaller RAM, which is, this is fast memory. So you copy maybe the blue part to here and process it. So you have to think where to put it, right? One block or what do you call it? Another name of the block is a line. A line is a multiple byte of memory. Okay. And we have to consider about the size of this block. Okay. It should be 16 bit. It should be 16 byte. It should be 1,000 byte. It depends, right? That it gives a different performance. Performance means how many hit or how many miss. We want to maximize hit, minimize miss. Okay. But hit and miss is reciprocate. So if you have the hit rate 90%, that means you have the miss rate 10%. Okay. And another thing is, when you copy from the main memory to your small fast memory, you pay some price in terms of clock cycle, right? So that's another parameter in designing this memory. We call that penalty, miss penalty. If you have to copy from the memory, if you copy a line, let's say a line is 16 byte, then there probably some, you have a few cycle, maybe 10 or 20 cycle before you can get all the 16 byte into the fast memory. We call that miss penalty. But let us revise our thinking a little bit and try to discuss this four question, okay? And try to answer these four questions, whether it's true or false, right? First statement is memory hierarchy take advantage of temporal locality. What do you think? Definitely, yeah. Temporal locality means if I access this piece of information now, I'm more likely to access it in the future. Okay, let me think deeper in that. What kind of piece of information that have that kind of behavior? I told you that maybe the instruction in the loop. Right? If your loop have five instructions, it probably jump back to the beginning of the loop. Right? So instruction is a piece of data as well. Right? Maybe instruction is most likely for temporal locality. Yeah. On read, that. Complete the first question. Second question, on a read, value return depend on which block are in the cache. when processor wants some piece of memory, it gives you the location maybe that let's use 110. I want to get something at location 110. There's two kinds that can possibly happen. First, processor consult the fast memory. Yeah, I want the piece of information. Give me. If it is there, then it's okay. If it is not there, then you have to copy from the main memory to the fast memory, okay? So, of course, we don't really know where in the cache, because the cache can be arranged in many ways, right? Just we say 110, in the memory, we know exactly, right? Because the memory have absolute address, you get what you want. In the cache, there's some kind of rearrangement, okay? Because the location in the cache is not continuous. It's not 100 to 200, no. It continuous only one line, but many, many lines can have, let's say the first line is 100, second line maybe 2000, because it just has to be continuous in the line, but the different line may not be adjacent, okay? So this depends on how you interpret it. I could say, well, yeah, it depends on which block are in the cache, but it also mostly depends on the absolute location of the main memory and where it put that piece of data inside the cache. Then most of the cost of memory are at the highest level. Let's think about that. Higher level mean further from processor. So you have the larger size, so lower speed. Okay. Actually, your RAM, right, is let's say today maybe 8 gigabyte, 2000 baht, right, and the speed is such and such. Okay, let's use that as a ground at a what call ground level and a reference level, and the more expensive maybe inside the processor, but we cannot purchase it on the market. the RAM inside the processor is as fast as CPU, though maybe 100 times or 10 times faster than your RAM. Okay, the RAM access, even DDR4, it probably is still not as fast as processor. Maybe different, maybe 5 times or 10 times. Okay, so let's say it is small, it is 10 times, but it's really small. First level cache is actually in terms of kilobyte. Yeah, kilobyte, maybe 200 kilobyte. Your RAM is 8 gigabyte, so it's very small, yeah, but it's expensive. We cannot put the cost exactly. But however, with another level of memory, I guess it's solid state disk. Now, I just bought one 500 gigabyte solid state disk. I just 500 gigabyte, 2000 baht. And the RAM, 8 gigabyte, 2000 baht, right? So can you see, if we compare this price of the two, the one is solid state disk is 250 gigabyte per 1000 baht, let's say, right? Meanwhile, the RAM that we put in the machine is 8 gigabyte per 2000, so 4 gig per 1000 baht. So we can now compare 60 times, sorry. Okay, but the cost is more or less constant, right? So price per speed or whatever, almost constant. This is how the market work. Okay, then now the last question. Most of capacity memory are at the lowest level. When we call memory hierarchy, you refer to picture 5.1, and it's okay. So most of the, you can see most of the largest is at the highest level, not the lowest level, right? The smallest and the fastest, okay? The last question is definitely false, right? All right. So with that main overall clear, now you can see that this picture is reflect our discussion. The fastest one is CPU, right? And there's increasing level further from CPU, and the block, the copy of memory is larger. Okay.